Hi everybody, Steve from Steve's Makerspace, and today I'm showing you something that I'm pretty proud of that I made in p5.js. I have two apps to show you that you can play with in your browser. They're both watercolor painting apps. This one is painting by itself using Perlin noise, and this one I can paint, I can change the color, and you can see that the colors run together here. I can increase the amount of paint I'm applying, and the paint gradually dries. Anyway, I'm going to show you a bunch of options and features of both of these apps, and then later in the video I'll talk in general terms about how I coded it. There are links to both of these apps in the description. You just play them in your browser. So we'll start with the regular drawing program. As I said, you can change the colors here. You can change that here. There's a dropper. You can grab a color from somewhere. Let's grab some black. Now we can paint with black. Then this is sort of like brush size, but what it's actually doing, it's dropping more paint. And so if there's more paint, then it's going to spread out. And these buttons here are about drying. So it's at a default drying right now, so it gradually dries. But if I keep this wet, then the dry time is lengthened, so it will stay wet longer. And so I'll do like this, and you can see that it's still blending together even though some time has passed. Now this one over here did not blend with this because this had already dried. And so if I come back to here later, you can see it's still wet, and it shows that here. But if I click on dry all, now it's all dry. I'm going to have to switch it back to default dry because right now it won't spread the color at all. So I'll do default dry, and you can see I can now go through here and it's not blending the colors as much. It still blends the colors a little bit. And we can look at some other variables you can change. This is the default drying time, and so you can increase this or decrease this to vary the default drying time. So runny colors is false, that's the default. So if I change this to true, we've got runny colors. I'm going to increase the amount of paint I'm dropping. I'll drop some red paint, and then I'll drop some blue paint like this, and you can see that it runs into the red and it falls downwards. If I put some blue this way, the red falls down into the blue. So that's the runny colors. If I change this though to false, and we'll do the same thing, I'll drop some red paint and then I'll drop some blue, and we'll go from both directions. You can see they do blend together, but they're not running as much, and they're also not going, it's not running down the screen. Another option you can change is the background. So if you wanted to start with all white, you can do this, and now it's completely white background. If you wanted a black background, you could change this to zero, and now you've got a black background. And then another one here is small canvas equals true. If I change this to false, it's going to fit the screen that's available to me. So now you can't see all of the screen right in this picture, but it goes way out to here and farther down. Also with the P5 editor, if you go to File, Share, you can Present. And here I've got a complete screen. It doesn't draw as quickly though, so I don't really recommend doing a full screen, but it is possible to do it. It's going to eat up a lot of resources and make your machine run slower. This is my best attempt at making a watercolor painting. I know it's pretty bad. So now we'll switch over to the self-painting. The only option you can change on the screen is this, adding more paint, but there are lots of options in the code. The self-painting is random, but it's not completely random. It uses Perlin noise, which is a type of smooth randomness. And you can vary the type of Perlin noise by changing some of these numbers in here. So if I change this from 0.08 to 0.8, we're getting a lot more twists and turns right now. And if I change this to 0.008, we're going to see some very straight lines. So we'll put that back to default. There's the color off add variable. This has to do with Perlin noise changing the colors. But if you want to change the colors, I would recommend skipping that and going to the color skip. The pixel skip is a way of drawing longer lines or shorter lines. So if I increase this to 22 instead of 12, you'll see it's still turning a lot, but it's drawing longer lines. Oh, there's something I forgot to mention. You can also click on the screen to pause it, and you can hit S to save a JPEG. And the other one, the one that you draw yourself, you can also hit S to save a JPEG. You switch the color skip from 7 to, say, 3. And now the color change is much more gradual. If I switch this to, say, 20, then we're going through a rainbow of colors very quickly. The dry time is at 0.0012. If I switch this to 0.12, it's going to dry a lot faster, which means that the colors aren't going to run much, and you won't really get large brushes. So I can increase this, but it's still going to appear very skinny because the colors are drying faster. But if I change this to, say, 0.0012, then it's going to stay wet and the colors are going to run more. So I think it's still wet all over the canvas, and so the colors are running together. It's very nice. I like that. Yeah, that's pretty cool. So we'll hit pause and save. Now we got our JPEG. I can open that up. There we go. Got something you can stick on your wall or share it with friends. It does take up more system resources, though, since everything is wet and it's constantly trying to mix the colors. We'll put that back to default. The running colors is false right now. I talked about that earlier. I can switch that to true. And so here the colors are running downwards. The paint is still drying in this case, but when two wet colors come together, they blend more and it comes down the page. We'll put that back. The canvas size can be changed. I've got this to canvas size equal true and a 400 by 300 canvas here. And so I could just change this to 400 by 400 if I want, and I've got a larger canvas. But you could also change this to false. And now the canvas is being drawn to the available space it has. It is going to run slower because it's got more pixels to deal with. So in general, I would recommend sticking with a smaller canvas size. Otherwise, you're going to be waiting a long time for it to draw. Although I suppose I could do pixel skip 32. No, it's still drawing pretty slowly. So let me put that back to true. There we go. And now it's moving more quickly. I'd also say that the running colors, when this is false, it runs slower. If I switch to running colors is true, it runs faster. And here are some pictures that the automatic watercolor painting machine has made. In a minute, I'm going to be talking in general terms about the coding of this. But before I do that, if you've liked this video or you like this application, what I've done, please give this a like. Consider subscribing to the channel and ring the bell for notifications. Comments are always welcome, and please share what you have done with this on my Discord. I'd love to see the results. Remember, there are links in the description to both of these applications. Now, I'm not going to go line by line through the code. I think that would be a very long video, but I will do a separate video if somebody requests it of going through all the code or even recoding this from scratch. To understand how this works, let's start by looking at Sandpiles by Daniel Schiffman. I made a few tweaks to this and showed it off in a previous video. The idea with this is you're dropping sand in one spot, and then when there's too much sand in that spot, it expands outward to the pixels that surround it. This is only keeping track of the number of pixels, and the color variations you see are the number of pixels that are left after it expands out. So with my painting app, it's similar to the sand piles in that I'm dropping bits of color onto the canvas. And if there's too much color in this one pixel spot, then it expands outward. But as it expands outward, it looks at the pixel next to it and combines the colors of the pixels next to it. This is all being kept track of in an array called paint, which has four values for every pixel on the screen, an R, G, a B, and the number of paint drops. If you're not familiar with how a pixel array works, I suggest you go check out this video by Dan Schiffman. It will be helpful in understanding what I'm doing with the code. The color picker here is something built into p5.js, and I'm just doing color picker equals create color picker. Here I'm creating a slider, creating a button, creating another button. Then I start by filling the array with background color. This is mostly so that I can later replace the items in that array. And I'm using a nested loop here, going through the X's and the Y's. This is pushing the values into the array, the R, G, the B, and the number of paint drops. The draw function is actually pretty short. The main functions that are called within draw are add paint, update, and render. These functions are for when those buttons are being pressed. So here the mouse is being pressed within the canvas. And here I've got some extra stuff that I had to add. Let me go to a previous version of this program. So here's a previous version, and you can see that as I clicked and dragged, it was skipping. What I was doing here was just changing the array based on whatever the current mouse position was, but the program couldn't keep up with the mouse position changing, and so it was skipping some values from one mouse position to another mouse position. So that's why we're missing some of the values. I found some help on Stack Overflow from someone named George Profenza. And so I copied a bit of his code. I've got a link to his code in the coding. So first it's calculating the distance between the current mouse position and the previous mouse position. And then I'm calling this function drawLinePoints based on the previous mouse position, the current mouse position, and the number of points that we want to draw between the current mouse position and the previous mouse position, because I can tell it that I want to skip some of the pixels if I want. Here's the function for drawLinePoints. And it calls at the end render points, x, y. So now that we get into the meat of this, the function render points. So for every point on that little line, it's going to be drawing from the previous mouse x and the current mouse x. We're going to come up with what the array position is for that particular pixel. Then we calculate a new red value based on the paint that's already on the canvas and the color that we picked in the color picker. The color picker gives us a lot of information. It's like a nested array. So this is how I had to grab the red value out of the color picker in order to put it into the array. It's colorpicked.levels 0. So I'm adding these two together and then dividing by 2 in order to get the average red color. And then I do the same thing for green, the same thing for blue. And then there's that fourth value in the array, which is the number. So I've got the paint that's already in the array, and I'm going to add to that the amount of paint that I've chosen to drop at every spot. Now, none of this has replaced anything in the array yet. That's what happens here. Paint.splice, the array position. This 4 is subtracting 4 items at that array position, and then this is replacing those 4 items with the new R, the new G, the new B, and the new number. Next is the function update. If there's a lot of color in one place, we need to spread it around. So we have another nested X and Y. You'll see this a bunch in here. Each time we get a new X and Y, we're calculating a new array position. And then we're checking, do we have more than 4 drops of paint on that pixel? I forgot to mention, we're going to be filling up a new array. I've got temp paint 1. Is an array that's going to replace paint. So this is saying if we've got more than 4 paint drops in the array, then in the new array, we want 4 fewer paint drops. So if we had 5, now we're going to have 1. Next, we're going to look at the pixels to the right, to the left, up and down from our current pixel. So in the pixel to the right of our current position, we're going to mix the current red of the pixel to the right with the current red of the pixel we're on, and we'll divide by 2 to get the average. And that average is going to become the new pixel that's on our right. Then I do the same thing with the green and the blue, and for the number of paint drops for the pixel on our right, we're going to add 1 paint drop. Then we do the same thing for the pixel on our left, same thing for the pixel that is below us, and the same for the pixel that is above us. Now we want to gradually dry the paint, so we're going to take the current pixel's number of drops and subtract from it the dry time value that we came up with. So it's going to be constantly reducing the number of drops in the entire array. I'm going to show you an old version of the watercolor painting. So this is what I first came up with. And if I add some color here, you'll see that the color runs downward. And I can do this, and again, the color is running downwards. That wasn't intentional. I didn't know why it was doing that, and it took me a while to figure it out. But the culprit is that I'm running through the X's and the Y's from the top left of the screen down to the bottom right of the screen. And so somehow calculating the top first and then the second line and then the third line makes the color run downwards. If I reverse this, I'll comment this out and comment this in. So here, instead of going from 0 to width and 0 to height, I'm instead going from the width to 0 and the height to 0 and subtracting along the way. So now I'm going from the bottom upwards. So let's see what happens when I run this. We'll put some color on, and now the blue, and you'll see that it's running upwards. So now the paint is flowing upwards. So the solution I came up with was to calculate both ways. I create one array, a temp paint one, for coming from the top to the bottom, and I calculate all of the same calculations from the bottom to the top, and I put that into temp paint two array, and then I average the two arrays. That got rid of the paint running problem, but it's a lot of extra calculations. So if you know of an easier way for me to accomplish this, please let me know. So here's where I'm averaging the two arrays and putting this into the paint array. And then finally, I'm rendering all the pixels. So this is just loading the pixel array, copying all the RGB values from the paint array into the pixel array. Then update the pixels. And this little bit down here is just saving the JPEG when I hit S. So that's everything for the manual watercolor painting. Now, the self-painting app works much the same way as the manual drawing app, except instead of using the mouse position to move the pixel about, we're using Perlin noise. And instead of using the color picker, we're randomly changing the color, also using Perlin noise to change the color. So if we look farther down in the code, you'll see that the draw line points call is here. But instead of the previous mouse position and the current mouse position, we're sending previous pause X and pause X. And pause X starts with a random value between 0 and the width of the canvas. And what we come up with to add to pause X, first we're getting a Perlin noise number, which I'm subtracting 0.5 here, so we're going to wind up with a number between negative 0.5 and positive 0.5. Then I'm multiplying that times the pixel skip. So that's it. Links are in the description. Send me your pictures. Give me your comments. Ring the bell and all that stuff. Thanks for watching. I'll see you in the next one. Bye now.
Steve's Makerspace.